When you think about disaster recovery, there's a lot of other things you have to think about besides the database. Join Chrissy as we learn about DBA tools and ways you can automate your disaster recovery for SQL Server this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, we're very lucky to be joined by Chrissy, and I'm going to let Chrissy go ahead and introduce herself.
Hey, my name is Chrissy LeMaire. I am a dual Microsoft MVP, awarded for my work in both SQL Server and PowerShell. For my day job, I'm currently a security engineer, but for over 20 years, I was a SQL Server DBA, and I used my PowerShell skill set to make that transition. I am also the creator of DBA Tools, which is the SQL Server module that was built by and for the community. It's available on GitHub. It's free. It's open source. It's really exciting.
Thanks so much, Chrissy. We're really excited to have you here today. And just for our viewers, like, this is a big deal to have Chrissy on the show because she is the creator of DBA tools. So really excited to have you. And today specifically, we're going to be talking about how to automate disaster recovery in SQL Server. And I'd really just love to pass it over to you, Chrissy. You're the expert. Can you tell us how to automate disaster recovery in SQL Server?
Absolutely. The first thing that I would like to do is define what is HA and DR. A lot of times, whenever you're working with HA and DR, you'll hear them coupled together, right? So HA is high availability, and high availability deals with minor outages, and the failover solutions are often automated. So things like availability groups and failover clusters. And the goal ultimately is to restore full system functionality in a short period of time. In my experience, that's been anywhere from 2 seconds to 30 seconds. Whereas with disaster recovery, this deals with major outages, such as natural and man-made disasters. So if you have a tornado that takes down your data center, or a fire, or even, you know, some sort of internal threat, then that's where disaster recovery would come in. And with DR, it focuses on manual processes and procedures to restore your systems back to their original state. And the expectation is that it does take longer than high availability. So whenever you're talking about DR, there are certain federal regulations that actually require it. And that's one of the reasons that you would want to set up, create, and test a DR plan. And also, business partners and customers often demand proof of disaster recovery plans before they even sign the contract. But this one is the most important to me, and it's supporting ongoing availability of IT services for business continuity. And when I was taking my class at Regis University, I was shocked when I read that a company that experiences a computer outage lasting more than 10 days will never fully recover financially. And within 5 years, 50% of those companies will be out of business. So, you know, with the prevalence of malware and ransomware, it's especially important to have a DR plan in place. Now, when it comes to SQL Server, a lot of people's first thought is databases, right? And I had this really awesome presentation. Tracy Baggiano created one on HADR, and you can find it at sqlps.io/HADR. And in there, she goes in depth about database disaster recovery. And one of the options is backup and restore, then also backpacks and DAC packs, replication, log shipping, which is one of my favorites, mirroring, and I know this has been deprecated, but a lot of us still have to manage older versions of SQL Server. Also, multi-site failover clustering and availability groups. So the scenarios, right? This is something that my professor had said. He said, the faster you want to get your data back, the more you will pay. And I thought that was really interesting, and I wanted to apply it to SQL Server. So the simplest and the most affordable is Ola Hallengren's scheduled backups. You can go to ola.hallengren.com, get his maintenance solution. And this is a solution that's recommended by Microsoft. It's free, it's open source, and I have used it at nearly every place that I've worked. And then you can take RoboCopy and replicate those backups out to a secondary data center or to the cloud. And then you also have the most complex and the most expensive, and that is a geo-replicated distributed availability group. And the reason, one of the reasons that it's the most expensive is not only are you triplicating your hardware and everything, you also have to get somebody, a consultant who specializes in this to get it set up right the first time. And you also have to have specialized staff that knows how to deal with geo-replicated distributed availability groups. So we've covered databases, but there's so much more. And I find that a lot of people forget about this part. Things like logins with their passwords and all of their properties, everything in SQL Server Agent, you have your jobs, your operators, your schedules, and so on. And then all of this, right? Your extended events, your linked servers with their passwords, your credentials, audits and audit specs, the replication, all of your configuration options, and so on. So this is a lot. And you can export it through SQL Server Management Studio. There are options where you can go and then right click. But imagine here's 20 options on the screen, and then each of these things could have 20, and then you multiply that times 20 SQL servers, and that is just way too much clicking. And I can see DR falling through the cracks there. But what if it could be less painful? And that's where DBA Tools comes in. So as I've mentioned earlier, DBA Tools is an open source, freely available community project. You can get it at dbatools.io, and it's super easy to install. So you just install -module DBA Tools, and this will install it for all users on the computer, including the SQL Server Agent service account. And then also, if you can't install two program files, you can also set your scope to current user and install it just for yourself. You can also go to dbatools.io/download, and we offer several different ways to download it. You can get it from GitHub, you can get it from Chocolaty, and so on. And we do want to thank Microsoft for the SQL Management Objects, or SMO. What's really awesome is when you install DBA Tools, this is all that you need. You don't need to install SQL Server Management Studio, because they have allowed us to redistribute the DLLs that power SQL Server Management Studio, and we super appreciate that. So I know it could seem overwhelming. We actually have over 500 commands within DBA Tools, but we also provide extensive documentation within each of the commands. And this is actually a test. If you commit a change to our repository, a test will run to ensure that everything is documented as it should be. And we also have extensive documentation on dbatools.io, and we've even made a few videos. So if you go to dbatools.io/YouTube or youtube.com/dbatools, you could see some of the usage there. So awesome. With that being said, we're going to do a demo.
Awesome. We can't wait to see this. I mean, you've already covered so much, and I think I'm excited to see how this works in action.
This is really, to me, I was so excited when we built this command, because it really simplifies all of that down to one single command. And this one, it actually wraps a number of other commands, but that's all done behind the scenes. You don't have to worry about anything. So I do want to make a note, I will be running this against my local machine, but that's because I'm a developer and I'm developing on this machine, and then I'm presenting about it through the machine. But when you install DBA Tools, you should only install it on a centralized management system similar to SQL Server Management Studio. You don't want that to proliferate all over your network, and the same is true of DBA Tools. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to take a look at the SQL Server. And you could see here, this is my workstation. I have some databases. I have some logins, login 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we have all of this, these sample objects that we expect will be there once our DR has completed. And then I have something called Pester. So Pester is PowerShell's test-driven framework. And it's really awesome. We use this for environmental validation. And here you can see it shows that it still has all the things. So it has all of the databases that are expected, all of the mail accounts, extended events, agent jobs, agent alerts, and so on. Everything is there. And this is the command that you can use with dbatools to export everything that you need to, unless you want to exclude something like your replication settings because you completely hosed it on your machine like I did. So what we're going to do is we're going to export DBA instance. The SQL instance is workstation. We're going to give it a path. And if you don't give it a path, it'll actually create one for you. And in this case, we will exclude the replication settings. So now we run this. And right now it's exporting all the configurations, all of the custom errors, all of the server roles, the credentials, the logins, all of your DB mail settings, your registered servers and CMS, the backup devices, server triggers, resource governor. Imagine doing all of this by hand. It would be torturous. And no, this is torturous seeing this. There's something wrong with my PowerShell proxy.
Oh, no.
It's usually prettier, and it was prettier earlier today when I was testing this out. So what I'll do is I'll just pretend that didn't happen by hitting clear. And then what we're going to do is we're going to go and look at the actual folder where it was exported. So you could see that it took the server name, and then it also has the date there. And then here's all the audits, the audit specs, credentials, and so on. And I do want to emphasize that it's not a DR plan without testing. And we do have a command that also makes testing your database backups extraordinarily simple. All you have to do is issue this one command. And what it'll do is it goes and it gets a list of your databases, and then it gets the most recent full diff and log. It performs a restore using an alternative name, and then it performs a DBCC check DB to make sure that all of the data has integrity. Yeah, it's super, super nice. A lot of people have integrated this into daily checks. So what we're going to do is we are going to test those output scripts that I created, and we're going to execute this drop.ps1. This also kills my SQL Server Management Studio in case I forget to go and refresh everything. So now it's dropping all of those databases. It's dropping all of the credentials, every single thing that you had seen earlier. It is performing all of those drops. Once that's done, we are going to test that everything was successfully dropped. Awesome. Now it's opening up SQL Server Management Studio, and we'll go and take a look. Now I do expect that since there was an issue for the first time ever, of course, right, while it's on screen with the credential, I do expect that at least one test is going to fail, but we'll see. So here we have the credentials. These are minimal credentials. All you remember, login 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, all of those are gone. So we have no databases here. When we go to agent, we have no jobs and so on. So what we're going to do is we are going to test that everything has been dropped. Oh my God, what a disaster, right? Look at all of that red. There's 22 tests that it ran and 22 tests that failed. This means that your SQL Server is out of commission, and it is time to use the scripts that were output by the export DBA instance command. So what we'll do is there are different ways that you can restore your databases and restore your objects. And what I'll do is, instead of restoring each of those SQL agent scripts, I am going to restore MSDB. And to do that, I need to stop the agent. And then once that has stopped, now what we're going to do is we're going to do a get DBA process, and we'll find all of the processes that are using MSDB, and then we'll just pipe that and kill those. We had one that was using it. And now we're going to perform the restore. So we're going to grab the files. We're going to exclude agent and replication, even though it didn't make replication. And then we will invoke that query. And of course, what you're going to want to do is go through this and you know, evaluate the scripts that are output and run this. But because it's a demo and I want to make it quick, we're just smashing everything in. We're ignoring any of the errors. And now we're going to run these pester tests after we start the agent. We'll run the pester test to see that everything has been restored. All right, so let's check to see if everything is back except for probably that credential. No, the credentials came through. Awesome. So we have 22 tests that ran and 22 tests that passed. Now, when we go back and we look at our SQL Server, when we perform a refresh, we can see that the databases are there, the logins are back, all of the SQL agent jobs are back, and we have successfully recovered from our disaster.
Wow, Chrissy, that was a lot, but it seemed like, you know, you were able to do it in such few commands, and I'm really impressed how you even encountered an error and we were still able to push through.
I am too. I'm not going to lie. I'm really excited that we had all that green at the end.
You know, I have a few questions, but I'll limit it to just a few. You know, I'm sure with your experience, you've seen a lot of this over time. What's the thing that like people most frequently forget, or like what's a big gotcha that people should be aware of when they go about using DBA tools to implement disaster recovery?
Well, I think before DBA tools, and this I think really talks to the power of PowerShell, we've made those checklists, right? And we have invested so much time studying what is it that needs to be restored. A lot of times people will only focus on their databases because that's what's easy to back up and restore. But you know, I think it's especially important to have all of your logins, to have all of your agent jobs. So my answer to that is, when it comes to DR, people often forget everything but the databases, but DBA tools makes it easy to implement your entire instance by exporting all of those files and all of those objects. And then what's really cool is that you could put that into source control and each night commit that to an external source so that it'll be available in the event of a disaster.
Right. I think it's really awesome that not only are you saving us a ton of clicks, but you're helping us a lot by, you know, helping us understand, you know, what else should we actually be exporting and making sure we keep track of. So this is just awesome stuff, Chrissy. You know, for the viewers watching that, you know, don't use PowerShell or are super new to PowerShell, like, do you have any advice on how they should even get started with, you know, with SQL Server and PowerShell?
Yeah. So if you go to dbatools.io/start, that actually has a guide of all the things that we recommend. Everything from books, like whatever media it is that you use to learn. For me, I like to learn from books, but other people like to learn from videos. There's even something called PS Coans. That's a PowerShell module. It makes it an interactive game to work with PowerShell. And that's listed there as well. And then also the community is always there, both in the SQL Server Slack at dbatools.io/slack and at the PowerShell Slack, which I don't remember the short URL for, but it is available and everybody's super helpful.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Chrissy. You know, I've learned a lot personally in this session. I'm sure our viewers have as well. I really want to thank you for coming on the show. It's such a huge honor to have the creator of DBA Tools here. For all of our viewers, if you like this video, please like this video, leave us a comment, and let us know what you think of DBA tools and some of the tips and tricks that Chrissy shared. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.